Last session at the Gujarat Literature Festival at this venue. All those who are interested can come and join us. I'll just brief about the session. The writer of detective fiction, travelogues, biography of Gandhiji in Swedish language, and several translations of Indian books into Swedish. We have Zac O'Yeah over here, who will be talking with literary enthusiastic and educator Lissa Chazot. So we have a Swedish writer over here who's based in India for last 20 to 25 years, and he will be talking about his journey of writing, his journey of translating, and the biography of Gandhiji which he had translated. So all the literature, fiction and non-fiction enthusiastic people over here, standing near the canteen, if you can hear me, near the book plaza, near the SEP plaza also on my right, everyone is invited for the last session over here at Kanoria Lawns with a Swedish writer who's now based out of Bangalore for the past 25 years. And he looks quite enthusiastic and interested. And he has a lot of questions to be answered. And I'm hoping that you'll enjoy this session just like the earlier section we have on fiction and non-fiction. So everyone is invited. A very, very warm welcome to all the guests who are already here. And we'll start the session in the next 2 minutes. Gujarat Literature Festival 4th edition. I am your host once again, Lippi Goyal, and I welcome all the bloggers, journalists, freelancers, fiction, non-fiction writers, book lovers, book readers. And in case I have missed out on any literary reader or literary creator, a warm welcome to that special guest. Well, I would like to invite the moderator for the session first, Lissa Chazot. She is working in the communications vertical at Mahatma Gandhi International School, as well as she's a consultant in Apple Education. I would like to invite her on stage. She will be asking some interesting questions to Zac O'Yeah, our next speaker. And I hope that it's a fun-filled session with a lot of interesting and inspiring questions and answers. I would like to now invite the speaker over here. Well, he writes detective novels. He's from Sweden, but now based in India for past 25 years out of Bangalore. He's a travel writer. He has written for Outlook, Traveler Magazine, National Geographic Magazine. He's also a literary critic, and he's written for Hindu, currently writes for Mint Lounge and Times of India. He's also a columnist at Business Line. I would like to invite Zac O'Yeah on stage for his session, A Majestic Swedish Touch. Hi, Zac, and greetings from Gujarat Literature Festival. I hope you have a good time over here. Yes, please. So we'll have a interview come conversational session for 20-25 minutes, and then we can open for Q&A. Yeah, lovely. Thank you. Enjoy. Hi.
Hi. Thank you everybody for being here and listening, and I'm really happy to be in Ahmedabad and Gujarat and having this opportunity to interact with you as an audience. I would like to start with those words.
Hi, Zac. So you have a very interesting name, Zac O'Yeah. Would you like to share the story behind your name?
Well, actually, the thing is that when I was young, I mean, I'm still young, but I'm not as young as when I was young. But I originally was thinking of becoming a pop star because I was very influenced by the music scene in Europe where I grew up. And as a pop star, you really need like a name that looks good on the record covers and that kind of thing. As a musician, I mean, as a pop star, actually, you don't really have to know how to play an instrument. I mean, I didn't know. I couldn't also sing or anything like that. But with a good name, you can get a certain fame, I thought. So then I started using the name Zac O'Yeah, which is, Zac is really a short form from my first name. And O'Yeah is from that Beatles song, you know, She Loves You, yeah, if you've heard that one. And I kind of figured that, like, you know, it has a positive sound. With a name like that, maybe somebody will love me in the end. And also it sounds better than Zac O'No. You know, O'No has a very negative, slightly negative, you know, down quality. So Zac O'Yeah sounded like popish and good. So I was working in the music industry for some time. until I got a little bit bored of it, because the constant touring, they're just moving from one city to the next and performing, and it started up. In the beginning it was a lot of fun, of course, but after some time it started to get very routine. And then I had this childhood dream of being a writer, so I decided in the middle of the career to quit the pop industry and start writing. The only problem was that I had to figure out what to write about. And that is actually when I came to India for the first time, because all the other pop musicians, you may have heard of the Beatles and groups like that, they all went to India. Even, I think, Rolling Stones and everybody else. So I thought, like, oh, if everybody else went to India, then I'll also come to India and see what happens. And that's when I actually wrote my first book. And then when the publishers were about to publish it, they were thinking, like, is Zac O'Yeah really a serious name for a writer? Like, will people think that this is actually good writing, or will they think that this is some crazy lunatic ranting type of person? But then in the end, they figured that, like, it's a kind of good name for a writer, because, you know, somebody can walk into a convenience store and pick up like a six pack of Coca-Cola, one Zac O'Yeah, and a packet of Marlboro cigarettes. So then I kept that name since then.
All right. So you were based in, you're from Sweden.
Yes.
And you learned Hindi in university. That is very unusual.
Well, that was after I came back from India, because when I wrote that first book, I spent some 2 years traveling around India. I mean, I came to Ahmedabad and went to various places in Gujarat, but also everywhere else in the country, more or less. And then when I came back to Sweden, I experienced a kind of reverse culture shock, you know, because I had gotten so used to India, where you will see some cows in the streets and some other animals, and on the way here I passed an elephant and things like that. And in Sweden we don't have any animals in the street. In fact, we have no people in the streets. Like, most people are just at home and or at work, or they commute, but they don't hang around in the streets as much as here. So I had a reverse culture shock. I was thinking, like, when I set foot in Sweden after 2 years, like, where are all the people? Have they all died? Has there been some nuclear war or something like that? Have they turned into zombies or something? So I immediately missed India, and I wanted to retain that connection. So then I thought, like, let me learn Hindi. So I started studying Hindi at the University of Stockholm. But during the first semester, I met this older student who had been studying for 3 years and done like a full degree in Hindi. And he had never been to India, by the way. So after 3 years, he went to India for the first time, and he landed in New Delhi, and he spoke with his university Hindi to people in the streets, and nobody understood a word what he was saying. And even worse, when people spoke to him in Hindi, he had no clue what they were saying, because the Hindi that they teach in the universities in the West is a very, you know, formal type of, like, old Durdarshan type of Hindi, you know, which, like, nobody actually uses. So then I sort of thought to myself, forget about this, I'll do something else. And of course, I mean, I did pick up enough Hindi so that, like, when I go to, like, if I spend any time in North India, then I can usually start communicating a little bit with people. And I watch Bollywood films, I don't need subtitles, so I know that much. But then nowadays I live in Bangalore in Karnataka, and there they don't really speak Hindi, because if you actually start talking Hindi there, people will get very, you know, little bit aggressive about it. Like, I mean, you don't belong here. So it's easier to get by with English, and because that's a very neutral language in Bangalore.
So you said that you came to Ahmedabad 20 years ago.
25 years ago.
25 years ago. So tell us what kind of changes you've seen in the city, and why did you come to Ahmedabad 25 years ago?
Well, I wanted it to be in the book, which was like that was actually more like a all of India travel handbook. So Gujarat was, of course, one of the more important states that has to be in a book like that. And also there's a lot of culture there, because my book was a lot about like the cultural scene, and I went to places like Darpana, the dance academy, and met at that time Rilaneli Sarabhai was still running it. And I met all kinds of artists and talked to them, and I put all that in the book. And also, the funny thing is, you know, like when I landed here yesterday, they had put me up in a hotel called House of MG in the old town. And that was like the very area where I was staying that time 25 years ago. The main difference was that I was staying in a hotel basically across the street from there, called Hotel Cadillac. It's still there. And at that time, I think I paid around 45 or 50 rupees for the room per night, kind of a very basic place. And now I am in a hotel where I think the rooms cost something like 15,000. So I don't know if it's inflation or maybe I become a better human, I deserve better accommodation.
So, Zac, you have written best-selling novels, yes, in India and abroad.
Yes.
But the latest 2 to 3 novels have an Indian setting, Indian theme, Indian characters. What drives that?
Actually, what happened was that earlier I would travel between India and Sweden. I would be in Sweden in the summers when it's quite pleasant there, and as soon as the autumn comes or the winter comes and it becomes unpleasant, I would come to India and just make up some project, maybe for some newspaper or something, to travel around and do some stories for them or something. But then what happened was that then I met my wife. Of course, she wasn't my wife when I met her, but I met her in Bangalore where she was living, and she's kind of she's an Indian girl, and also actually a novelist. And I kind of fell in love with her at first sight. She didn't fall in love with me. So it took like quite a few journeys back and forth, you know, to convince her that we should get married. And she didn't really want to move abroad because she has her family in India and she's very attached to her family. So, and I really didn't want to live in Europe that much any longer. So it seemed like a good idea to just for me to move to Bangalore. And in the beginning, when I was living in Bangalore, I did write books mostly in Swedish for the Swedish market. But after a few years, I moved to Bangalore in the year 2000, by the way. Since then, I've been living there. After a couple of years, like 5-6 years, I realized that I can't write books about Sweden anymore because I don't know what Sweden is like. Because in the 1990s, when I lived in Sweden, people didn't really have mobile phones and that. I mean, no, mobile phones had come, but it was a very new thing, and there were other changes there. So I realized that I don't actually know this country anymore, because if I would write a novel set in Sweden, it would be like a historical novel about, you know, last century or last millennium even, actually. And if I wanted to write books that were relevant for this millennium, the best thing would be to write something about Bangalore. Also had this dream of writing detective novels. Since I was a child, I was like big reader of Sherlock Holmes and Agatha Christie, and those were like my favorite books. But then when I became like a serious writer, people were telling me that you can't write detective novels in Sweden because it, you know, Sweden has the slightly progressive culture and detective novels are not considered good literature. So I was sort of sidetracked and doing all kinds of other things, trying to write serious books and, you know, serious novels that would sell like 300 copies or 400 copies or something like that. And but then when I was in Bangalore, I realized that actually at that time also there was like a big wave of Swedish crime fiction of writers like Henning Mankell and Stieg Larsson, who wrote the Millennium Trilogy. You may have come across that because it was made into a film with Daniel Craig, the James Bond guy. So like Swedish crime fiction has started to become like a big industry. So living in Bangalore, I thought like, why not write a detective novel set in Bangalore, and where I use that Swedish background that I have, you know, a certain expertise about crime fiction or thriller writing, but try to kind of create something that is more Indian, you know, and use Bangalore as a setting, because I find Bangalore infinitely fascinating as a city, because it's almost like a village that has 10 million, you know, like 1 crore population type of thing. And that has sort of grown, and with all the strange things that happen, that you walk across in Bangalore and you'll be like in the city center with all those high rises, and then you'll turn one corner and there'll be like a more like a village type of setting where people will sit under a banyan tree and drink tea, you know, like that.
So how did Hari come to you as a character?
Well, he came in the sense that once I decided that, okay, let me try write an Indian detective novel, I realized I need to have a protagonist. And of course, there's a slight difficulty if, since I'm not born and grown up in India, although I've now spent 25 years here, I was still a bit apprehensive, like what kind of character I can write about. And also, I didn't want to write like a typical Western type of crime novel set in Bangalore. You know, like a typical Swedish crime novel, the hero will be, if it's a male hero, he will be an middle-aged policeman who is sort of overweight, drinks too much beer, eats too much pizza, he's slightly diabetic or something like that. He'll be divorced and had a problematic relationship with his children, and slightly depressive character. And if it's a female hero, it'll usually be a journalist or a freelance journalist who will of course not be fat and ugly like the male hero, but like very good looking, but she'll be also like drinking too much wine, she'll also be divorced, she'll also have a problematic relationship with her children, and a slightly depressive character.
So how is Hari different from these very sad heroes?
So Hari came to me first because I watch a lot of Bollywood films and Kannada films and Tamil films, and I saw the kind of heroes and the storytelling techniques that are typical for Indian cinema, which is different from Western. Like in Western crime novel, it'll be like on the same level. It'll be like slightly dark, brooding, action, violent, some amount of gore and that kind of thing. Whereas an Indian action film, as you all know, it will have the hero like Shah Rukh Khan bashing the crooks and all that. But Shah Rukh Khan, will, while he defuses bombs, he'll also do some comedy routine and, you know, make us laugh. And then he'll also have some romantic affair, which like, you know, complicates his, you know, heart matters, and in the end, I would cry when, you know, Shah Rukh Khan finally gets that girl, and in the last heroic scenes of the film. So I thought that's a very different from the typical Western crime novel. So I wanted to do something like that, and so, I thought like for my hero, I would use a character who is like a tout. You know, touts are these people, if you travel a lot and go to some tourist destination, when you get off the train or bus or something like that, there will be a fellow who will say that, come to my hotel or come to my Kashmiri handicraft shop, and before you know it, you bought a carpet for all your travel budget is gone into that. And so Hari Majestic, the protagonist, is in the beginning of the first book, he's a bit like that. He is a slight con man and takes tourists for a ride, but then due to some actions of his, one tourist gets into a very bad spot, and he feels, because he watches Kannada movies, they were all these heroes or very, you know, good people, like they rescue damsels in distress and all that. He feels that he should become a hero. So that mistake that he makes in the beginning of the first book, it propels him into becoming a hero. And I thought like a tout is also an excellent detective rather than having some, you know, policeman. I mean, because I have a slight impression that Indian policemen don't often solve crimes that much, but they sit and drink tea more, like, or, I mean, there's not that much like detective hero types among them. And also, I didn't want to do a journalist or something like that. So Hari was the ideal person who is like a tout. He knows the streets. He knows the, like, all the bad places in the city. He knows the good places and everything in between. So I thought he was like a perfect detective. And as far as I know, nobody has really written about a detective character like that. So like when I realized that, then the whole thing came into place. You know, a combination of Bollywood and street life. Or Bangalore.
So usually writers do a lot of research before writing their books. Have you had any first-hand experience with gangsters and criminals to be able to write your books?
You know, as a novelist, we really don't hang out that much with gundas and all that kind of thing. It's not like maybe like crime reporters and that kind of people do. But I do have, and it's very interesting because, you know, in Hollywood films, the gangsters all like, they have broad shoulders and big muscles and they're like, you know, really bad guys. Whereas in reality, if in Bangalore, I had this experience some time ago. I was walking in the area where the books are set, which is a somewhat downmarket area called Majestic, where the hero Harry Majestic's name comes from that area. So I was walking there and I had been to the bank and I had taken out like 10,000 rupees, which I had in my pocket. In those days, you could actually get money from banks. Like nowadays, as you know, we can't. But so I was carrying this amount of money. And also like today in Bangalore, if you have 10,000 rupees and you go out with 3-4 friends, all that money will be gone in one evening. But in those days, it was actually possible to, you know, pay for your expenses for like almost an entire month. So it was quite a lot of money. And then I was walking there and then I was suddenly surrounded by these gundas. And there were like maybe 10 of them who stood in a circle around me. And I thought, I noticed immediately that this is not a very good situation for me. And I got a little bit worried. I was thinking, should I just take out the money, throw them on the ground and run? And the gundas were just standing. And the gundas in Bangalore are like they're not like those Hollywood guys with the broad shoulders. But I know in Gujarat you have prohibition, but some of you may have seen an old monk bottle of rum. And it has a shape more like shape is more like that. So if you imagine like these old monk bottles that are like very big and with legs underneath and small heads on top, so these 10 guys look like that. And so then finally the main guy said to me, "Give us 20 rupees." And my reaction was exactly yours. I started laughing. And all these gundas started looking at each other. What is this lunatic foreigner laughing? We're, you know, threatening him and he's just laughing at us. And so while they were confused, I started quickly walking away with my money in my pocket. And when I come like some 30, 40, 50 steps away, they were like, "Hello, come back, we're trying to rob you." But by that time, I had already disappeared in the crowd. So that is like the fundamental difference between Hollywood gangsters and Bangalore gundas. And that I think like as a travel writer, I also work as a travel writer quite a lot. I often, when I go to some new place, rather than just reading the travel guidebooks, I try to pick up a detective novel, like a Chinese detective novel or an Australian crime thriller or American thriller or wherever I go, and read it to get like a different view of the city, of its social landscape and so on. So I feel like detective novels are like the ideal vehicle to explore a city, you know, from various social strata of the city. Because essentially what you do when you write a detective novel is that in the beginning you need to have a crime, which is usually a murder, but it can be some disappearance or something else. And in the end you have to have a solution. But in between, your detective can go, you know, he can knock on any door, he can talk to all kinds of people, and you get kind of an interesting picture of a city if you read or a place if you read a detective novel.
So you've read many detective novels from different countries.
Yeah.
What kind of differences have you noticed, say, detective novels from Japan versus detective novels from Australia, for example?
Well, Japanese thrillers and detective novels are often like very, you know, scientific, very systematically built up and very, you know, there's a lot of like mathematics, like did that person go there on that day or that hour and how did that work, and it's like a more like a crossword puzzle, you know, and in the end the author will reveal like how it all comes together. An Australian detective novel or thriller on the other hand is often like deals with the social problems of Australia. And the typical hero in Australian thriller would be often like a forensic psychologist, often a woman, or some form of psychologist or psychiatrist who deals with the problems in society. So, like between subtle differences, essentially crime novels are entertainment, and ultimately you get all that, you know, fighting and all that action and thrills and all. But there is that under it, the base is relates often in a good crime novel, I should say, the base will relate to the culture of that country.
Moving on to the thrill of traveling, since that's your second passion.
Yes.
What are the perks of travel writing?
Actually, there's not really any perks. Like, you're on the road and you live alone and you face all kinds of difficulties trying to understand where you are. And I often come to a place and I'm wondering, asking myself, why did I even accept this job? I mean, how stupid am I to... But then the nice thing is really like when you start to know a place and you discover something, you know, like different foods, like for example, street foods of Ahmedabad, or like I find it amazing, like the things you see on the roadsides, and I like to try everything, and so far I'm still alive. I think I have a little bit of cholesterol in my heart that is sort of, but other than that, you know, so the nice part is that you build up like an experience of a lot of different places, and you get to go to many different places, and you get like a larger understanding of the world, and then you also understand, you know, the similarities between humans in different places, that we even though we may seem very different on some level, we all have a sense of humor and we can laugh at similar things, and so there are things that you realize that, oh, because as those of you who are interested in history will know that these national borders are a fairly new thing. Like a couple of hundreds of years ago, there were hardly any national borders, but people were like moving around freely and connecting with each other and migrating here and there. And it's only in the last couple of hundred years that we've started saying that this is a border and here you need a visa and you have to have a passport and you have to have a this thing and that thing and all that. So when you experience lots of, so I mean, what am I trying to say actually with this thing? Yeah, what I'm trying to say is that these borders have kind of alienated us from each other, whereas we are all like one big family when, you know, deep down.
One of your earlier books was a biography of Gandhiji.
Yes, that's
correct. And we are in the land of Mahatma Gandhi.
Yeah.
So if you could please share a few anecdotes or a few insights from that book.
Yeah, that was, I came upon this idea because I'm not only a fiction writer, I also write I've been writing non-fiction quite a lot. And after I'd been living in India for quite some time, I realized that in Sweden, where I grew up, there's not any like proper biography on Gandhiji. And even in Scandinavia, I mean, there are some books. His own autobiography has been translated, of course, and there's some academic texts that can be found. But they are not, his autobiography is a brilliant piece of literature. I mean, it's one of the finest Indian books ever written. But there is nothing like very accessible in way of biography for the Scandinavian readers. So I thought, let me write a small pamphlet and to explain to people there about Gandhiji and like what he was actually doing. Because there everybody knows Gandhiji because there was a film by Richard Attenborough where he was the sort of star. And so they've seen that film and they have like a vague idea who he was and where he came from. But not like a deeper understanding. So I started working on this book and I traveled to the places where Gandhiji had lived and done much of his work. And I went to London to see the places where he lived when he was a young student there. And And the more I was digging into the matter, the more fascinated I became. So that pamphlet kept growing and growing, and at some point it was like 1,200 pages, and the publisher said you have to cut half out. But there was so much to write, because I realized that he was not only like a political leader, but he had interesting ideas about health and diet and media, and he was a journalist himself and a publisher of magazines, and so many interesting aspects of him, which is not generally known to people. I mean, you all know everything I know because you live here, and your relatives may have met him long time ago. So, but like in foreign countries, people they can't understand his greatness beyond his the political achievements he has. So in the book, I try to highlight all these other aspects about him, and I discovered, even when I was reading Hind Swaraj, there's a small mention, some of you may have noticed it. He says something about, like, in the future, technology will be such that we just press a button and we get the news of the day. And I thought, like, this is what we have today with tablet computers. We press some, click some link, and there'll be news on our telephones. So he already had that idea that this is where we're heading. And even his approach to his writing in his own magazines, on some level it can remind us of like present day bloggers, because he shares his personal experiences and stories a little bit like a blogger would do today. And even the way, like, he would receive a letter from somebody, and he would just, and there would be some questions or something, and he would turn it around and write his answer on the back of the letter, or if the back of the letter is full of text, he would just open the envelope and write his answer inside the envelope and return it to the person who wrote him. So I was thinking, like, if he had access to email, he would have loved it, because you can click and you don't waste paper on emails and things. And he was very conscious about not wasting paper, so that was one of the reasons why he did it. So I think, like, and he was also one of the earliest private persons to own a printing press, in fact. So he was, he embraced technology to a much higher degree than we tend to think, because we think of him as he was walking around, you know, with his staff and doing all these, the Dandi March and all that. But he was actually also very interested in technology, and especially rural technology, technology that could help rural people to have, you know, more ecological and better living circumstances. And when I started reading these things, I thought, like, my God, like, now we are starting to think of ecology in the last few decades. But he already, like, 100 years ago, he was there. So he was, like, a very visionary person. And so that kind of things really amazed me when I got into these things.
On a concluding note, what does this saying, I have a dream, what do you dream of?
Oh, that my books would be pirated and read everywhere.
Thank you very much. We are now open for Q&A.
If there's anybody, you can ask even silly questions, I don't mind. But smart questions are also nice, I don't mind that either.
I'm telling a silly thing. People of Scandinavian countries are descendants of sage Brigi, Bhrigu Rishi, because Bhrigu Rishi has four sons, Shand, Murk, Tvasta and Kavi Ushnas. And Shand and Murk migrated to some thousands of years ago in these Scandinavian countries, and you people are descendant of this Skand and Shand and Murk. That's why from the name of Skand, your countries are known as the Scandinavian countries. You are descendant of great Hindu Rishi Bhrigu.
I think you're absolutely right, because I often have this feeling that I was Indian in a previous lifetime, and then due to my poor karma, I was born in there near the Arctic Circle in the snow and rain and all, but now I'm back.
So you're cousin brothers.
Absolutely.
Hi Jack, this is Abhishek this side. I would like to ask you specific questions regarding the travel, right? You know, you do a lot of travel and you write your own travel diaries, right? So I often introspect myself, like, you know, whenever I used to go on a long traveling journey, then I would always introspect in myself, like, how can I get most out of this thing, right? Mm. And how can I start developing that views, you know, which can actually, you know, make my travel diary healthy, right? So what kind of observations or what kind of things you, you know, keep in mind, you know, while traveling, and what are small or minor things you observe and write in your diaries? So, you know, that way I can actually, you know, help, you know, to improve my yeah. If you can, you know, throw some light on this.
I think one very important thing to keep in mind is that although it's very good to research the place where you're going to travel to and, you know, find out something about it so that you don't come there entirely unprepared, it is also very important to disregard all that information. Because if you just look at, like, all the tourist sites or the main things that they tell you in the tour guides or the guidebooks, then you'll miss out, like, maybe 90% of the place. So what I do whenever I come to a place, even here in Ahmedabad, from my hotel, which is on the other side of the river, I would walk here to the venue, even though they offered me some car or something like that. It's like, not for me. And then on the road, you see things and observe things. So, like, the way I approach the new place where I go to is I always walk around as much as possible until my feet are hurting. And it always leads to some interesting discoveries, because you'll end up coming. And it's also, like, very good to try to get lost, like, in a city. Like, try to not think about, oh, I have to go to that in that direction, or which direction am I going. Just go, like, randomly and lose yourself as much as possible in that place. Of course, don't do this in a jungle where there are elephants and tigers, and I'm talking about cities right now. So because in a city, like, once you've lost yourself totally, you can always
take you back to your hotel or something like that.
Jungles are a slightly different thing. There you need to wear your mosquito net and all that.
Hi, my name is Tushar, and I really loved your sense of humor. I haven't read your books now.
They'll be available here if you want to sign a copy. So I'll sign for free, but you may have to pay something little for the book, you know.
I'll now read them. But I want to ask you a question that, you know, they say that tragedy is the mother of comedy and humor. So are there any special events that have shaped your humor or something specific?
I would like to highlight also that he writes comedy crime thrillers. That's important to highlight.
Exactly.
So it's very, very unique.
It's a mixture of tragedy and comedy. It's a very complicated question. I mean, I've often been thinking of writing an autobiography to explain all the scary things that I've been through. But generally, I think my writing has been shaped very much by the fact that I've always been traveling between cultures and meeting people of all walks of life, and it's even my own writing is not so much about me. The characters are not based on me really. Well, I mean, a little bit maybe, but, like, generally, it's all fiction. And to write good fiction, the one thing you need to do is, like, to meet a lot of people, talk to all different kind of people, and get an understanding of how, you know, different people think about different things. So my writing is more than based on some all the tragedies that I've gone through, about, like, the social experiences I've had in my life. And I may seem very young to you, but I'm actually quite old, but though I'm still young.
Hello.
Hi.
What keeps you motivated writing books?
One of the reasons is that I get invited to places like this and talk to people like you. And also, it is as a job, it's a quite nice job if you're thinking of taking it up, because you decide yourself, your schedule, and how you plan to work and what you're gonna work about with, and so all the decisions rest with you. There's no boss as such. The only thing is that you need to have a lot of self-discipline, because your publishers will expect to get, you have to finish the book and give it to the publishers at some point of time. So one has to be a very disciplined worker, but one is one's own boss. So one can still decide that, oh, now I'll go for 1 month to China, or, you know, whatever one feels like as a writer. So I like the job because of that, and it gives you a lot of time to think, and you get a lot of time to read, and you get a lot of time to talk to other people and meet different kinds of people. So writing never gets really that boring. But of course, when you sit in front of your machine and you're typing and all that, and your back is aching and your arms are aching and your eyes are getting dry and all that, it can also be quite a terrible job. So sometimes I think maybe I should quit and become a coffee planter or something like that. I like coffee a lot. Indian coffee.
Yes,
sir.
See, as you explained, that your wife is also a novelist, and you are also,
yes,
a novelist, right? So, two novelists in a family, what kind of interaction you have regarding your art of writing, and how do you interact?
It's actually, I think, a very good thing that we are both novelists, because if only one of us was a novelist and lived that kind of crazy life, and the other one was a normal person with healthy habits, it could cause a lot of conflicts. But since we both have this sort of very irregular lifestyle, we have a very good understanding of what the other person needs in terms of space to work, and we don't disturb each other. And then, yet you have that thing that, like, when you sit and have lunch together on lunch break time, we can bounce ideas between each other and discuss, like, so how's your writing going? It's like going like this or that or whatever. And it gives you a certain, reassurance that you're not totally alone, because otherwise being a novelist can be a very lonely job. And actually, lots of novelists, of the ones who work alone, have developed like bipolar diseases and ultimately committed suicide and things like that. So I think, like, one of the reasons why I haven't committed suicide yet is because my wife will tell me that no, it's not a good idea. It can end your career. Even if sales will go up, it won't really benefit me. So that's one of the things, and then ultimately also you have like an editor, like an experienced reader next to you, so who will work for free. Sometimes I have to take her out for dinner or something like that, but like otherwise she doesn't ask for money. So I get like a good editing done, first editing done on my books and stories, and likewise I provide that service to her, so that like when the manuscript goes to our agents and publishers, it will already have gone through a very professional first edit, and so the chances that the publishers are happy about it are slightly higher. So generally I would say that it's a good idea to marry a writer if you're a writer, but if you are not a writer, please avoid marrying a writer, because they're very strange people. Any other question? Sir.
Okay, last question.
Thank you for asking for question.
One more.
I want to ask this year. This year is Nobel Prize.
Yeah.
Bob Dylan.
Yes.
Who received the literature Nobel?
Yes, he was given a Nobel Prize.
Sweden.
Yes.
How can we write good poems and novels? Then I am also a poet writer.
Mm-hmm.
So how can we get this type of big prize? And what we do, then we come there.
Do you play the guitar?
No, I am tabla player also. Poet.
So yes. Tabla playing and you sing your poem, very rhythmic poetry it will have to be, no?
Chess, I think chess champion also, chess player.
Yeah. So I think I have some friends who are like pop managers and who have worked with like famous groups like Wham and T-Rex and all these things. And he often points out, like, for example, have you heard of Wham, George Michael? He's a pop star from the 80s. So he often tells me, like, the thing with somebody like George Michael is that he's actually, first and foremost, he's a poet. He writes the lyrics himself for his songs. And then it happens that he puts them to music and he performs his poetry the way he does it. And so my friend Simon, when he was working with George Michael, he saw this process happening, and George Michael also as a poet, I mean, he loved to be on the arenas and perform for like 1 million people. And also, of course, he would earn $1 million every night he performed. So as a poet, one will have to think like that thing, that poetry is not necessarily something that you write in a very introverted way and you will show it to some girl and impress her and all that kind of thing. But poetry is also something that you write for the world, and the world is your audience. And that attitude is what George Michael had and many of the other big pop stars. I'm not a big pop star, I mean, so I never made it that far, but some of them do. I hope you will do also.
And I mean, Marut Raval.
Thank you very much.
You'll get the next Nobel Prize, I think. Yes.
Thank you very much.
And thank you all for listening so attentively and for your good feedback. I'm very happy to have had you here in the audience tonight.
Thank you so much. This is the first time that I don't have to say a huge round of applause. But let's have once again a huge round of applause for Zac and Lisa, the Swedish writer, funny at heart, young at heart. Thank you so much for sharing your journey and answering the questions. I hope you had a good time at Gujarat Literature Festival.
Thank you. It was a wonderful literary festival. And like I said, if anybody would want to pick up a copy of a book, yes, I think a few of them are available.
Right. So on the right-hand side over there, the copies of his book are available. This was the last session over here. And now we can all of us move ahead to Sepp Plaza, where we have the thank you ceremony, the concluding ceremony of Gujarat Literature Festival. Once again, thank you to everyone, each and everyone sitting here, each and everyone hearing me near the canteen or at the bookstall. It has been an amazing experience being part of Gujarat Literature Festival, having audience, such a varied audience from all the different avenues, fiction, non-fiction, writers, storytellers, journalists, bloggers. I'm sure you must have heard me also at a lot of sessions, and I'm sorry if you found me a little irritating. But thank you so much, and I hope to see you in the next edition. Thank you so much, Zac and Lisa again. And I'll see you at Sepp Plaza for the concluding ceremony. This is your host once again, Lippi Goyal, signing off.
Okay. Wind up. Wind up, na? Chalo, mana batai diya udhar daro. Aao, dhone ida maan. Kaso hoga. Recording to chalu na. Recording.